Welcome to EPG Patashala. I am Dr. Muralikarnam. Today we are going to discuss about the role of National Human Rights Commissions in the promotion and protection of human rights. In the earlier module, we tried to discuss about how Supreme Court evolved over a period of time and how it tried to protect human rights and what are the safeguards provided for ensuring the rights of the citizens in the form of constitutional remedies and in the form of judicial review by the Supreme Court. The Protection of Human Rights Act provides for formation of national state human rights commissions in India. The legislation and the formation of commissions are the result of long drawn discussions at the international level for more than two decades. The learning objectives of this lesson is, after reviewing this module, the student will be able to describe the standard principles of human rights commissions and their implications on the government's commitment to human rights. Identify and characterize the various features of human rights commissions as provided in the law. And the student will also be able to identify the most important roles NHRC can play. Explain why a properly constituted NHRC has the ability to improve the country's human rights record. Most of the human rights arise and are to be enforced against the entrenched interests of powerful in the society. In liberal tradition of human rights developments, all individual rights are rights against state and limiting the power of the government. The history of growth of human rights tell us that governments have reluctantly acknowledged the rights and limited them in enforcement even after long struggles by the citizens. These same governments are expected to promote and protect human rights. The history of the world tells us that the governments have always been one of the primary sources of human rights violations. They are also expected to create appropriate institutions to meet the demands of democracy. These circumstances of human rights origin, their violations and enforcement demand that the national institutions created for the enforcement of human rights should match the historical task. It was perhaps felt that this task of evolving appropriate institutions cannot be left entirely to the governments themselves. The Indian Constitution has provided for fundamental rights for citizens, drawing from the experiences of many countries. The Supreme Court of India, by interpreting the directive principles of state policy, could expand the ambit of human rights. The setting of norms of human rights has been robust, but the effort to build a national human rights protection system has been of recent origin in India. During the last decade of 20th century, not only in India, but also across the world, this effort has been goaded by Paris principles, which set the minimum standards for human rights institutions. The principles laid down by International Workshop on National Institutions for Promotion and Protection of Human Rights held in Paris 1991 are known as Paris Principles. They were adopted by United Nations General Assembly in 1993. These principles define the status and functioning of human rights institutions to be set up in various countries. The institutions that are considered to fully comply with the Paris Principles are accredited with A status, while those that partially comply are accredited with B status. Institutions of A status are allowed to participate in the work and discussions of the United Nations Human Rights Council and its mechanisms. There are more than 100 internationally accredited human rights organizations, including NHRC, across the world. This testifies the importance of these principles. The first fact to be reckoned with is that all the systems of human rights protection are part of structures of state. They are created and funded by the state. Yet, ensuring their autonomy and independence is the biggest challenge for protection of human rights. Paris principles propose that the human rights institutions are required to protect human rights, including by receiving, investigating, and resolving complaints from citizens and mediating conflicts and monitoring activities. It has to promote ideas of human rights through education, training, capacity building, advising, and assisting the governments. In order to get international accreditation and recognition, the fully functioning human rights institution has to meet 6 important criteria. The first criteria is that the mandate of the institution must be as broad as universal human rights norms. The promotion of rights is needed to change the dominant attitudes and behaviors of citizens in general, but decision makers in particular. An institution with a narrow mandate cannot promote rights which are universal and interdependent. It should be competent to investigate human rights violations of a specific nature. The human rights institutions are to be backed by constitutional and statutory mandates, and they should not be created by executive orders. Roughly 1/3 of human rights institutions in the world are given constitutional foundations and the rest statutory backing. The ultimate foundation can be including the mandate in the constitution, as the statutory mandate of human rights institutions can be tweaked and weakened by other statutes. The third important criteria for a successful human rights institution is autonomy and independence. The principle of autonomy includes legal, operational, and financial autonomy. The mandate of the members of institutions should have legal autonomy in order to ensure the stability in the functioning. The institution should have capacity to conduct its day-to-day work independent of executive. It should be able to draft its own rules of procedure, and that cannot be modified by any other authority. The decision of the institutions should not be subjected to any external approvals. The financial autonomy of the institution includes the availability of adequate funds for salaries, for hiring of staff, and for required infrastructure. The independence of the human rights institutions means independence of its members. Their tenure and selection and process should be immune from the influence of political decisions. The terms and conditions of being members should be part of legislation, and they should work as safeguards. The human rights institutions should also have adequate powers to investigate and be able to exercise them directly. The legal binding powers to call and compel witnesses to appear and to require the production of evidence should be made available to the institutions. Even when these institutions are quasi-judicial, these powers are necessary. Another crucial feature of any independent human rights institution must be its pluralistic composition. It must ensure the pluralistic representation of social forces that includes the members of civil society, social groups fighting against discrimination, from trade unions, associations of lawyers, doctors, journalists, and experts from universities. The representatives of government should participate only in the advisory capacity. The above are minimum standards provided by Paris principles, under which human rights institutions, commissions, and tribunals are accredited by the International Coordinating Committee of National Institutions for Promotion and Protection of Human Rights. The protection activities of human rights institutions should include rule of law, the administration of justice, and fighting impunity. They can promote law reform, strengthen standards of judicial and security institutions, but the core protection activities of these institutions should concentrate primarily on the prevention of torture, arbitrary detention, disappearances, and the protection of human rights defenders. Along with this activity, the institution should review the conditions in detention facilities, visiting facilities, announced and requesting private interviews with the prisoners. These are standards according to which Indian Human Rights Commissions are expected to function. Let us see now how National Human Rights Commission has been formed. Formation and its functioning also, well, let us take a look. And also let us see the role and functioning of NHRC. The Protection of Human Rights Act 1993 defines the word human rights quite broadly, converting rights relating to life, liberty, equality and dignity of the individual as guaranteed by Indian Constitution and embodied in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the International Covenant on Economic, Social, Cultural Rights. Indian Constitution, of course, guarantees the rights of social collectives also, which is not specifically mentioned in the Protection of Human Rights Act 1993. The National Human Rights Commission under Protection of Human Rights Act has been assigned the functions of inquiry of violation of human rights or abatement or negligence in the prevention of such violation by a public servant. The involvement of a public servant indicates the focus of the Human Rights Commission. It can intervene into any judicial proceeding on allegations of human rights violations before a court. The Commission can take up these activities on its own initiative or on behalf of the victims or complainant. Any judicial institution can also direct the Commission to undertake any inquiry into human rights violation. It can visit any jail or any other place of detention to study the living conditions of prisoners and make recommendations. The original Act of 1993 mandates that Commission can visit under intimation to the government, but this rider was removed through the amendment to the Act in 2006. This change was brought to force in order to assess the real living conditions of the prisons. The Commission can also review any law that has implication for human rights and recommend appropriate remedial measures. It has the mandate to undertake study of international instruments on human rights and make recommendations for their effective implementation. It has a duty to promote research in human rights field. As part of promotional activities, it should encourage the efforts of NGOs working in the field of human rights. What powers have been vested with the Commission relating to inquiries is something that we need to discuss now. The Commission has been vested with quasi-judicial powers and has the power of a civil court. While inquiring into the complaints, it can summon, enforce the appearance of any witnesses and examine, call for any public document and receive any evidence on affidavits. These powers are very important to exercise the operational autonomy of the Commission. The law provides for the Commission to have an investigation staff of its own to look into the complaints. It can also use the services of any officer of investigation agency of the central government or any state government. In addition, it can also associate itself with the NGOs in the investigation work. The autonomy of the Commission is something the Paris principles talk. The autonomy of the members, financial, operational autonomy of the rights commissions. The Commission's autonomy comes from the method of appointing its members, fixity of their tenure, statutory guarantees, and the status they have been accorded. Section 32 of the Act provides for financial autonomy of the Commission. The committee comprising of Prime Minister, Home Minister, leaders of opposition in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha select the members of Commission. In order to ensure the plurality of representation of the members, the chairpersons of Scheduled Castes, Scheduled Tribe Commissions, Women's Commission, the Minorities Commissions are also made members of NHRC through an amendment to the original Act in 2006. Clause D of the section of Act stipulates for appointment of two members from civil society who has knowledge and practical experience on human rights issues. In the past 25 years, the governments have not been able to find any members from the civil society to occupy these honorable positions. The Supreme Court, the National Human Rights Commission can inquire into a lot of complaints. The Commission has a standard way of engaging with complaints. It calls for reports on the issues involved from the concerned authorities with a time limit within which they have to respond. If the report sought by the Commission does not come within the stipulated time, it proceeds to inquire into the complaint on its own. In case the Commission feels satisfied upon the perusal of a report that the concerned authorities have taken up the steps to redress the complaints, it does not proceed with the complaint. It also informs the complaint accordingly. In case the Commission feels satisfied upon the perusal of the report that the concerned authorities have taken up the steps to redress the complaints, it does not proceed with the complaint. It also informs the complainant accordingly. So what steps are open to Commission after inquiry is something that we need to discuss. But if the Commission is not satisfied, it will inquire into the complainants and take few steps. If Commission concludes that the human rights violation by public servant has taken place, or he or she has failed to prevent one, it recommends to the government the initiation of proceedings for prosecution or any other action fit against the persons involved. It can also, on behalf of the complainant, approach the higher judiciary for a redressal of the problem. It can recommend to the government for the grant of immediate interim relief to the victims and their families. The authorities have the responsibility to respond to the recommendations of the Commission with the action taken report within 1 to 3 months, depending upon the nature of the complaint or gravity of the complaint. Procedures to handle the complaint against the armed forces are very, very different. The Protection of Human Rights Act prescribed different procedures when the armed forces are involved in the human rights violations. The armed forces which are trained to use maximum force against the armed forces of the enemy countries are prone to resort to human rights violations when they deploy against the civilians within the country. When such cases are reported widely, the Commission can seek information from the government. After receiving the report, the Commission can suggest measures to be taken by the government. The Protection of Human Rights Act provides that the government has to submit the action taken report against the allegations of human rights violations within 3 months. The Act further mandates that the Commission should publish its report along with the recommendations made and the action taken by the government on the recommendations. The petitioner is entitled to a copy of the report. In this regard, the Commission functions essentially as a watchdog and monitor of human rights conditions by making concerned authorities publicly accountable for their actions. The limitations on the complaints is something that we need to discuss. The complaints against violations of human rights, which are universal and inalienable, cannot be instituted after 1 year of their violation. The Commission doesn't have power to entertain 1-year-old complaints. Similarly, the complaints which are already lodged before any court cannot be inquired into by the Commission. The service matters of the government employees also do not come under its purview. These are the limitations. What are the kinds of issues on which the complaints have been received so far by Human Rights Commission? The Commission has been handling various types of complaints from the citizens. As far as police are concerned, failure to take action, unlawful detention, false implications, custodial violence, illegal arrest, custodial deaths, encounter deaths, harassment of prisoners, and bad jail conditions are the types of complaints. In addition, it has been receiving the cases of atrocities on scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, bonded labor, child marriage, communal violence, dowry death, abduction, rape, murder, sexual harassment, and indignity to the woman and exploitation of women. The focus of the Commission, inquiring into the complaints, is one of the major activities of the Commission. In several instances, individual complaints have led Commission to the generic issues involved in violation of rights and enabled it to move the concerned authorities for systematic improvements. However, the Commission also actively seeks out issues in human rights which are of significance when brought to the notice by the civil society, the media, the concerned citizens or expert advisors. Its focus is to strengthen the extension of human rights to all sections of society, in particular the vulnerable groups. The Commission's purview over the entire range of civil and political as well as the economic and social and cultural rights, areas facing terrorism and insurgency, custodial death, rape, torture, reform of the police, prisons and other institutions such as juvenile homes, mental hospitals and shelter for women have been given special attention. The Commission has urged the provision of primary health facilities to ensure the maternal and child welfare essential to life with dignity, basic needs such as potable drinking water, food and nutrition, and highlighted the fundamental questions of equity and justice to the less privileged, namely the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, and the prevention of atrocities perpetrated against them. Rights of the disabled, access to public services, displacement of populations and especially of tribals by the mega projects, food scarcity and allegations of death by the starvation, rights of the child, rights of women subjected to violence, sexual harassment and discrimination, and rights of minorities have been the focus of Commission's actions on various occasions. Now let us discuss about major initiatives. One of the first initiatives of the Commission has been a detailed public inquiry into the fake encounter deaths in Andhra Pradesh. The Commission concluded that the procedure followed by the police was opposed to the law and indicated the correct procedure to be followed. The Commission issued elaborate standards of procedure to be followed in the event of deaths in the encounter between police and political militants. One of the major achievements of NHRC is responding to the protests of the human rights organizations all over the country and writing to the lawmakers of the nation not to revive the draconian legislation of Terrorist and Disruptive Activities Prevention Act in 1987. The Commission documented elaborately how the police abused the legislation and how hundreds of thousands of citizens were thrown behind bar without convictions. Similarly, the Commission also contributed its mite in the elapse of the Prevention of Terrorist Activities Act quota. It has reviewed the Prevention of Terrorism Bill 2000 and made its recommendations to the government from a human rights perspective. It prepared guidelines to check misuse of the power of the arrest by the police. It ordered all the state governments to set up human rights cells with police departments. It prepared steps to be taken by the police to check these deaths, rapes and torture in the police lockup. It initiated a debate on the Convention Against Torture, additional protocols to the Geneva Conventions, and opined that Indian government should ratify them. It pointed out the need for refugee law for the country because we don't have that. It initiated the studies of reform, police reform, prisons and other centers of detention. The members have been visiting prisons, mental hospitals, recommending necessary measures to improve their conditions. While these being the core activities of the Commission, on economic and social and cultural rights front, also it has been initiating dialogue with government on elimination of bonded labor, child labor, and problems concerning the right to food. It also focused on prevention of maternal anemia, congenital mental disabilities among children, rights of persons affected by HIV/AIDS, right to public health and rights of the vulnerable groups as women, children, minorities, scheduled castes, manual scavengers, scheduled tribes, including denotified and nomadic tribes. It has been organizing human rights training for civil society, the armed forces, public authorities, police, civil society and students. By bringing out annual reports, newsletters, research studies, it has been promoting educational activities on human rights. Few instances of working of NHRC are being discussed below so as to provide an insight into the student. The Supreme Court of India entrusted Commission to monitor the implementation of Bonded Labour System Abolition Act while disposing a writ petition by People's Union for Civil Liberties. The Commission collected information on identification, release and rehabilitation of bonded labourers and constituted a group of experts to examine the issues involved and prepared a report on the status, methods of improving and their conditions and made recommendations to effectively implement the laws for abolition of bonded labour system in various states. It appointed special reporters to interact with state governments and the Ministry of Labour to evolve suitable measures. It organized workshops to all the authorities concerned in Punjab, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and Karnataka in 2003 and 2004. Let us discuss about instances of relief. the commission has been granting compensation to victims of custodial violence and the deaths. The accused who died in police and prison custody and who were tortured were all granted relief from rupees of 1 lakh to 50,000. A careful examination of records of commission reveal that the commission is taking 2 to 4 years after institution of the complaint to dispose of the cases. The grant of compensation is further delayed by the state governments in many instances. The quantum of compensation and the delay in the disposal of cases needed to be taken a fresh look given the gravity of the human rights violations. The government and the NHRC, how the functioning? The functioning of NHRC in relation to various human rights violations is not easy. The nature of the relation between the government and the commission may strain sometimes depending upon the gravity of the human rights issues. To illustrate the difficulties in performance of the commission and the response of the government, the death of 20 laborers in the hands of police Chittur of Andhra Pradesh is discussed. 20 laborers of Tamil Nadu were killed in Seshachalam forest by a team of police and forest officials in the early hours of 7th April 2015. The victims belong to backward and scheduled tribe communities. There was a nationwide outcry against these killings. The NHRC immediately responded to the incident and started inquiry. It heard the depositions of the civil rights groups and invited police and other government officials to record their version. Some civil rights groups had already filed a writ petition before the High Court of Andhra Pradesh. The representatives of the government who appeared before the commission refused to provide the information about post-mortem reports, the names of the personnel, the nature of the weapons used in the incident. They had taken refuge in the order of the court, which stated that a confidentiality of the results of investigation would be maintained and presented only before the competent court. The commission tried to give appropriate interpretation of the court order and pursued them to share information required for discharge of its duty under Protection of Human Rights Act. The commission proceeded to next stage of inquiry at the place of incident and ordered the government to direct the concerned officers to cooperate with the investigation. The district magistrate, police officials refused to cooperate with the commission. It has also visited the villages of the victims and found out their families live in economic misery. On 28th May 2015, the NHRC released its report and expressed its dissatisfaction at the response of the government and made 6 specific recommendations to the government. It directed the government of Andhra Pradesh to pay rupees 5 lakhs as immediate interim compensation to the kin of each of the 20 persons killed. It also ordered the district magistrate to disperse the financial assistance to the 12 tribals under Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes Atrocities Prevention of Act Rules of 1995. An investigation into the killings by the CBI within 4 weeks was also directed. The commission also recommended adequate protection to the witnesses who escaped the killings. Finally, it ordered that the Chief Secretary and DGP of AP to appear before the commission with all the records sought by the commission. The orders of the commission were to be complied within 4 to 8 weeks of the time, 8 weeks of time. Now, 1 year is over after issuance of these orders. The government of AP, instead of complying with the orders, moved the High Court and got stay order against the commission's order. The commission is left no option but to challenge the orders of High Court and wait for the response of the government. In conclusion, we have to think that the module discusses the foundational principles for the formation of Human Rights Commission and translation of them into legislative intent in the Protection of Human Rights Act 1993. The composition, autonomy and performance of the commission have been examined. The contribution of the NHRC in promotion and protection of human rights has been elaborately discussed. The roadblocks in the protection of human rights and the structural limitations have been dealt with in order to provide a realistic picture. Yet, it is important to understand that the human rights institutions have a tremendous potential to improve the human rights record of the country. Thank you for watching this video.